Hello and welcome to the In the Tank podcast, episode 211, the podcast that explores work of think tanks across the country. As always, I'm your host, Donald Kendal, and we've got kind of a different episode here for you today. The most of the Heartland family is probably off at the benefit dinner. And a little behind the scenes, we're actually pre-recording this episode, but we don't have the usual suspects in-house. Sitting across from me, we have producer extraordinaire, Andy. How are you, sir?
Glad to be on the show again, Donald. Folks, I've been getting your emails. I know you all want me on here more. Just glad to be on the show.
That's right. Andy, I'm going to put you on the spot for a minute here.
Okay.
We haven't done a video podcast in a while.
Yeah.
What's the deal, man?
All right. So we were doing those through Google Hangouts for a period of time, and then Google Hangouts was shut down on a Thursday before our usual Friday live show. So we're in the midst of rebuilding that process. We got the Anthony Watts, the owner of What's Up With That, coming in soon to help us on our system, and we should get it back up and running because the video show was way fun.
Yes, and you actually had a role in that show.
Damn straight.
Unlike now.
Hey.
But we are going to be talking about a number of topics here, but what makes this show extra special is that we have a guest joining us via the internet, who is Robbie the Fire Bernstein, King of the Cocks. How are you, good sir?
A pleasure to be here, and I'm happy that you got all my titles correct. Otherwise, I would have hung up. So,
yeah, I was going to say Slayer of the Soho Forum, but yeah, so I don't know. Maybe you're like Daenerys from Game of Thrones, and your titles just grow and grow and grow over the course of the seasons.
That's what I'm hoping for. Slayer of the Soho Forum is not bad, and you know what? We're going to add that to the credits.
We'll do. Next time we have you on, I'll make sure to attach that. So, Robbie, there might be a lot of people listening to this podcast that don't know who you are. You are on the Part of the Problem podcast. You are also the host of Run Your Mouth. What else you got under your umbrella? Give us like an elevator pitch of who you are.
Oh, okay. Well, firstly, I'm a sandwich extraordinaire to get across to people. People that tune into the Run Your Mouth podcast, it's not just for insight on politics. It's also for recommendations on how to properly bread a sandwich, what kind of condiments are working best in there. So we really do take our sandwiches seriously. Aside from that, you know, I do stand-up comedy. I'm a career sales guy, and I get to podcast with Dave, which throws me into this wacky little libertarian landscape.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So before we get into the topics, and just to kind of give the audience a little heads up, we're going to be talking a little bit about cancel culture, some class warfare with Bernie Sanders, some government banning certain products. We'll get to all of that. But before we do, again, just kind of fleshing out our guest star here, Robbie the Fire Bernstein. So tell us a little bit about just how you got into the libertarian mindset, I guess, because I think we all kind of have different journeys.
Yeah.
In high school, I went to high school during the Bush years, so that kind of defaulted me into being a liberal. Until I was exposed to Ron Paul, which really opened the doors to me.
Ron Paul got you?
It was
actually Al Gore that sent me in.
I'm sure. But yeah, what's your story, Robbie?
Wait, how do you end up here from Al Gore?
No joke. I was sitting in a seventh grade science class, and they were showing An Inconvenient Truth in that class. And at the end of that documentary, I'm just talking to my friends, and I'm thinking, like, did anyone else find that deeply manipulating? And they were all like, no, this is a huge problem. And just watching that film, like, something rubbed me the wrong way. So then I actually got really heavy into the climate space, which is what drove me into Heartland eventually. But after following the whole climate change narrative and seeing how it was essentially a tool for global elites to micromanage the world, essentially, mm-hmm. That kind of drove me more and more into the libertarian movement. So I'd like to give Al Gore credit for making me a libertarian. Thank you, Al Gore. I know that's what you always wanted. And great film you put out.
Man, you were a smart seventh grader. I'm a little intimidated now.
Don't worry. It just went downhill from there.
That was 35 years ago.
There you go. So many people got to hear via Ron Paul. My trajectory into this landscape is a much slower development. I definitely started off as anti-government because I was a big pothead in high school. And that really just opened up my eyes to the fact that government's not my friend. Yeah. I really didn't feel like I was doing something that was so horrible to society that there should be a possibility of jail time for the activity. So really just from a young age, I had the outlook of, hey, government's not my friend. And then I was lucky that when I went to college, I was, you know, I majored in finance. And what's interesting about finance versus like gender studies or sociology is that there's actually money involved.
Yeah.
And there's people trying to make decisions that will make the money. And as a result of that, those people do have a much more rational perspective about what's going on in the world. Like, go work in your average hedge fund. If those guys aren't libertarian, they at least understand economics and like they're not pro-government or they understand kind of the racket and the lies. Like they really understand the bigger picture, and that's because they're placing bets on what's actually going on. So being exposed to finance in college, I even had a class in college that was it was the political science of economics, and it was basically like the study of why, you know, we have some very good ideas for how the world should operate, and we do have some good economic principles, but why is it that governments never put these things into action? One of the books we read was The Logic of Political Survival, which really kind of was a book about how, you know, politicians are in the business of just trying to be in power. Mm-hmm. That's the commodity that they're looking for. So I was kind of exposed to a pretty anti-government perspective. I wasn't really even aware that libertarian was a thing. I later discovered that word from the comedy of Doug Stanhope, who's one of the greatest ever, my personal favorite. And then eventually, you know, I was hanging out with Dave Smith, who doesn't shut up about this stuff. And he introduced me to, you know, Murray Rothbard and some of the more traditional thinkers.
Yeah, so that actually kind of, you bring up Rothbard, that kind of sets up a question that I kind of had for you, which is, it's a kind of a problem that I run into a lot when hosting this podcast is, you know, we typically will feature different articles or studies that are done by these academic think tanks across the country, whether it's like the Cato Institute, Heritage, Mises even. But a lot of the times I feel like I'm reading off all these stats, like, for example, let's say like Medicare for All, and we're talking about how it's going to cost $32 trillion. But that doesn't take into account reimbursement rates that, you know, the hospitals get. And it just almost seems like too abstract. So I don't think that that's a problem when I'm like listening to you and Dave Smith talking about these concepts. So can you just kind of speak to that, I guess, and just kind of like how these messages are better getting it to the just the general public, I guess?
Well, firstly, I'm honored at the fact that you're dealing with think tanks and you're looking for my perspective on it. So that's quite flattering. You're like, listen, we're doing the academics over here, but I feel like you might have the perspective.
Right.
No, I would say here's the biggest thing, and I both follow politics and I'm a salesperson. And the number one thing that we need to be doing is really just talking about the benefit to other people. So the liberals, they do a very good side of that. Every time they're talking about free healthcare or they're talking about any of these things, it's always here's what I can provide for you. Now, I think we can understand like big numbers are very abstract to people. The concept of a billion or a trillion.
Exactly.
You say that to somebody, it doesn't even mean anything. They just go, oh, there's a big number here. What would work better is kind of really breaking down, hey, here's the cost. That's like, you know, we all kind of make decisions intuitively. We do a cost benefit analysis about everything. So you've got politicians who are up there and they're telling, hey, here's the benefit. I'm going to give you free healthcare. So what we have to do is really expose, well, what's the cost of that free healthcare? And it honestly, it needs to be a little bit more than, hey, it's $37 trillion.
Right.
It needs to be, hey, here's what's going on in foreign countries. Where people are working for slave wages, you know, you really got to get into like the weeds of here's what's going wrong with society because we're going to print $37 trillion to get you healthcare. And part of that is, listen, the healthcare that you're going to be getting is not as good as if Walmart and Amazon were providing it to you because they're actually just better at providing these items.
Right.
So the large number of $37 trillion or whatever the hell it is, it's not enough information. You then have to break down, well, what happens when government prints $37 trillion? Like, what's the cost of that? Is that, hey, we're going to see hyperinflation by this year? You know what I mean? Like, you got to get into the weeds of here's what the cost to you is going to be. Here's why this is not going to work out for you. And that's when people can start, you know, you have the specific examples of the harm that's going to be done by it. That's where you're going to get some eyeballs.
Yeah, no doubt. And that's actually kind of the things that really appealed to me when I was kind of going through the whole Ron Paul stage back in 2007, 2008. And like one of the things that, you know, I like to bring up, especially in terms of the healthcare debate, you know, the government wants to give you universal healthcare. Well, let's see what they're doing in the UK with this. And some of the things, you know, the rationing is really getting to the level where they are basically rationing their care based on your behaviors. So if you are considered obese, then, you know, you are put on the back burner when it comes to certain like non-priority things. If you're a smoker, same deal. So it's once the government is in control of this, you know, despite what all the costs are going to be and what the taxes might turn out to be and the benefits that you would get, if this system, which puts the healthcare in the government's hands, and now that gives them justification to tell you how you should live your life, to me, that is more effective than any giant abstract number.
Picking back off that a little bit, I mean, I actually grew up in London for a couple of years, and I'm pretty familiar with the National Health Service, the NHS, which is essentially just a public health service, healthcare for all, you know, terrible system. But the way it works there is, You go to these doctor's offices and they would just have a TV on the wall, and there'd be 30, 40 people in there, really crowded. And you'd just wait until your name showed up. You'd wait in there for literally hours just for a random doctor's appointment. Mm-hmm. But then
healthcare.
Yeah. Oh yeah, it's terrible. And then I had like an issue with my left wrist. I had a ganglion cyst and I couldn't put any weight on my left wrist. But when I went to the doctor, they said, like, look, this isn't life-threatening. You can still live your life normally. We're not going to help you. Yeah. So we were both being taxed to pay for the National Health Service, which determined that my inability to put weight on my left wrist wasn't deemed worthwhile, and then had to pay for private healthcare who actually would give me the care. So not only is it not a good system and it provides worse care, it forces people to pay for both, which really prices out those that need this healthcare the most.
Yeah, and to me, that, I feel like... Go ahead, Robbie. Sorry.
No, I was going to say a dumb joke, so it's probably better off without it. Go ahead.
No, I'm curious.
Yeah, but to me, like a story like that is probably more effective for somebody listening and how this system could affect me than me spouting off numbers like $37 trillion over 10 years ever could.
I would say here's the biggest selling point. Government wants to tell us, hey, we can provide health care for you. I know for a fact that there were soldiers who called on to the suicide hotline and were put on hold. Look at what they've done in the VA. And the point is, they are lying to you. When politicians say, hey, we can provide these things, they can't. The proof is the cost of this is going to be $37 trillion. And then you got to break down. Here's why we can never have $37 trillion to spend. It doesn't exist. They can't do it. And they're lying to you. Sadly, amongst all of the failures of government, it's amazing that they continue to go, well, if you just gave us more resources, we can figure it out. Like, I know that we didn't get all those other things done, but it's just because you didn't give us enough of the money. There's got to be a way to really convey that, like, no, they're lying to you. They can't really do it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And all right, so let's get into some of the topics that we have here. And for constant listeners, this might sound familiar because I just talked about it last week, but I want to get Robbie's perspective on this as well.
And it's going to be more interesting than that last guy. I don't know who he was.
That's right. So I was watching the Thursday night football game, and afterwards, you know, it was on like Fox or something. So Fox local news came up. And Andy, you might be aware of this, Robbie, you might not, but a few months back, there was a Cubs fan at Wrigley Field that during like a post-game interview with somebody or whatever, this guy in the crowd is doing the circle game, right? He's doing the little OK symbol below his waist in the line of the camera. Basically, you know, playing the circle game. If you look at it, he gets to punch you type of thing. It was something that was big in high school when I went. But anyways, the outrage mob just seeked him out and destroyed him. Eventually, Wrigley Field said that person is no longer allowed in the stadium
for life
because this OK symbol apparently is looked at as a symbol of hate. So this have you heard of that, Robbie, first of all?
No, and I almost need a minute just to digest the levels of stupidity here.
Yeah.
let me go a bit further with this story.
Go ahead.
So I am a Cubs fan. Even though this happened, I'm still going to be a Cubs fan. But here's the really malicious part about what happened here. That same week that this guy got banned for life for doing the OK sign, Addison Russell, a Cubs player that was, I mean, I don't know if he's been officially convicted, but he committed domestic violence, was allowed back onto the team. So he's there on the field playing someone that, you know, beat his girlfriend. And at the same
time, allegedly,
they're banning someone for doing the OK sign. I actually think to a degree it was to create a story to get away from the Addison Russell stuff. But, you know, it just when you look at it like that, it's like, do we really consider the OK sign worse than, you know, what Addison Russell did?
Well, sure.
Allegedly.
Also, doesn't Chicago have the most murders in the U.S.? Like, they're worried about OK signs.
Yeah, know? Right? That's the problem.
So you got to break it down to me first. Where did they come up with that the OK sign was a symbol of hate?
Okay.
That like...
Well, yeah, sure, we could do that. So This actually started as a 4chan troll that they basically wanted to see if we could get the media to think that something as minute and pointless as you know, connecting your index finger to your thumb and sticking up your other fingers is some type of symbol of hate. And they succeeded, by the way.
Yeah.
So it just kept going and going.
Just trolled the media into pretending like that's some ancient symbol of hate.
Exactly.
And the media just went with it.
That is exactly the case, yes. So fast forward, so keep that in mind, that Cubs player. Fast forward to this past Thursday when I was watching that that football game. They go to the local news and they talk about how the Anti-Defamation League has basically just designated that symbol as a symbol of hate.
And I feel like I'm being punked here. Is this all factually true?
This is real.
This is real. This is not fake news. We're not on the CNN podcast. So So anyways, so they're showing this, they're talking about it, the anchor is talking about it or whatever. Then they show like the stock footage of that guy at Wrigley Field doing the OK symbol under his waist in front of the camera, and they blur it out.
Oh, no way.
I kid you not.
Wow.
This is the world we are living. This at that, to me, was peak clown world.
It's tough to even comment on because, like, if anything, that's just a perfect showcase of how bonkers they are. That's clearly just lunacy. And then, like, that's how do you even have an argument with that? It's just, it's literally nonsensical. It's hard to even digest.
So I was doing a little bit of, you know, show prep because I kind of wanted to talk about this. And there was some article that linked to that thing that I had you pull up right at the beginning.
Yeah.
Go to that real quick. Right. So so this article, it was from NPR that was just talking about how the ADL designated this as a symbol of hate. And it pointed to a list of all of the things that are considered hate symbols. And you just kind of scroll through this. Look at this. Like, pretty much the number 100% is somehow tied to white supremacy. The number 14, apparently.
We got to post this in the show notes. This is insane.
Keep scrolling down. Oh, the word the number.
They really got into the weeds on this.
The number 18, the number 23, apparently. The number 28, 311, which if you're a fan of that band, apparently you're in the white supremacist. 38, 43. Like, it's just, there's pages and pages and pages of this. But like,
they put the best minds to work to decipher exactly how much racist undertones were in the OK symbol and how much it can convey. It's almost like a demon thing that if you just look upon it, it's like seeing the number 666, the message of the devil. Wow.
Yes, well, yeah. I'm pretty sure that if you play this podcast backwards, then you actually hear some coded demonic messages. Too,
oh, absolutely. So. That's what we do.
So we'll probably end up on this list soon.
The Anti-Defamation League, they're kind of Jewy, right? And I don't just mean that because they're annoying. I think they're like Jewish run, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's specifically about anti-Semitism.
So just to like point out and showcase the stupidity of the Anti-Defamation League, I don't think I'd ever heard of them except 4 or 5 years ago. I went to see Roger Waters was doing the Wall concert, and I was going with it was my dad, another guy, and the other guy's dad, who's like a pretty noteworthy rabbi, been a rabbi for like 65, 70 years. The Anti-Defamation League had put out this article, I think in the Times or wherever it was, saying how Roger Waters' new thing is the, you know, totally anti-Semitic and we got to get it shut down. And this lady walked up to this rabbi in synagogue and starts yelling at him, like, I heard you're going to see Roger Waters tomorrow. How dare you? Like, really just letting him have it about. And the guy, he just didn't care. He's like, yeah, I kind of want to go see the concert. Hilarious rabbi. Anyways, we go to see the concert. And the one thing that was of issue was essentially At some point, like, there's, you know, I guess they, it's a pretty theatrical thing. He builds like this whole wall there, and he's got like these airplanes coming down, and they're dropping like symbols, and amongst the symbols are just religious symbols, which happened to have included a Jewish star. It also included a cross. It also included whatever that moon thing the Muslim people yeah. like. I don't know what you call those. You know what I'm talking about? The little half moon. Yeah, the moon
thing. It's called the moon thing, yes.
Yeah, in academic papers, that's how it's referred. The moon thingy thing. The point being, it was like there was nothing about this that was in any way anti-Semitic. I don't even know how you could possibly sit down and go, hey, this is anti-Semitic. So as a person who's Jewish, hung out with other Jews, I don't know what that Anti-Defamation League people are doing, other than being whiny and, if anything, you know, playing into anti-Semitic tropes.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, that the idea that, like, all of a sudden that we are going to seed this symbol that you could see everybody doing. There's pictures of everyone. We saw that, you know, happen. They had pictures of Barack Obama doing it, AOC, everybody. You know, it's a symbol, you know?
Yeah.
I'm doing fine, whatever. But the idea that we're going to seed this to, you know, the white supremacists, it just seems like it's self-defeating. It's like if white supremacists were all of a sudden like a fan of, you know, the newest Marvel movie, whatever, I don't know. Do you know what the latest one is?
Not a fan of them.
Let's say Spider-Man.
It was Spider-Man, yeah.
Yeah, let's say like 12, 12 legitimate white supremacists started talking about Spider-Man. Is the ADL going to come out and say, Marvel Spider-Man, that's a symbol of hate now. Sorry. Like, it just seems self-defeating to me.
Oh, yeah.
And this kind of, to me, kind of ties into the whole, like, cancel culture. It is kind of a cancer. But the idea that, like, are these standards that they're setting up for society impossible to meet? Because it seems to me that it's they're going to start eating each other. And Robbie, I know that you just said that you were a stand-up comic. So can you speak to that and kind of how that affects the comedy world, I guess?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first, just kind of, you know, to tie it into the circle thing, it seems like whatever they want to get outraged about, they'll kind of get their way, because people seem to, if CNN and everyone's outraged about it, they kind of take the perspective of, well, they're outraged, they must be right, and heads have to roll. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if it can happen with something as stupid as a guy holding a circle up at a baseball game and being banned from the stadium, I guess that is the most extreme and absurd position ever. So that would be proof to the fact that whatever they want to invent as being a problem is now a problem. It exists in reality and is something that somebody's going to get punished for, which is insanity. What exists in the comedy world is similar to me, in that, like, this is the craziest part, is that to me, if you watch any episode of Family Guy, I never watched Family Guy. The other day, my roommate had it on. I saw a Quagmire rape joke. I saw jokes about cripples. Mm-hmm. Like, there's nothing being said at a comedy club, in my opinion, that's any more offensive than what you see most nights on Family Guy.
Sure.
What I see is the outrage cancel culture. It's like a form of bullying where, for some reason, they're going after the weak. They're going after comedians that are at the beginning of their career, who are just performing at clubs, probably barely getting by. And if there's really so much, like, horrible that's pervaded by people who make inappropriate jokes, then there's no reason to me why every single night we're reading articles in outrage about the jokes being made on Family Guy. So it really is just a form of bullying that for some reason they're going after specifically low level or beginning stage career comedians that don't have any power. And the strangest part about it is that, like, I don't know, they take this approach that, like, stand-up comedy is this unbelievably important thing. And so it's really important for society and culture that only certain topics are, but at the same time, it's like, these people don't do stand-up comedy. They're not the people that show up to clubs and spend money for stand-up comedy. So, like, if it's so important to you, I guess, why aren't you then involved in the art form? Mm-hmm. Why is your involvement in the art form just policing it? And, like, why do we need a police for something that, to me, it's a free market activity. If people show up to the club, they laugh, and they're spending money. I'm not really understanding why we need this third party who pretends to represent some silent majority that's offended and thinks that this is corrosive to society. But show me the numbers. Who is that silent right. majority? Who exactly are these people, the masses, that you're the one person speaking up for? And that, I'm ranting a little bit here, but that, to me, is the absolute craziest part, is that it's like these small bloggers who don't even seem to have massive fan bases that are kind of controlling the narrative, that they're popping up out of nowhere. They're going, hey, what this one comedian said was offensive, and that's having real world results, where I think if you go talk to 97% of the country, firstly, I bet 75% of the country doesn't even know about the Shane Gillis story. They're not even aware about it.
Yeah.
And I bet you could pull as high as 90% if you told them the facts on the ground. Like, if we literally had a vote on it, they would go, yeah, this is stupid. So the fact that, like, in my opinion, from the people that I talk to, there's, like, unanimous support for the idea that this is ridiculous. So I don't know why it's as, you know, pervasive as it is. There's something there that's just, like, not really adding up in my head.
I have two theories, okay, and they probably both overlap. But my first theory is the idea of it's something that's based in kind of the pre-internet, and it was the idea that, like, if a company were to get a letter, like a complaint letter, they would look at that single letter as if it was representing 10,000 people. Because if it was, if something happened that they did that offended somebody, for somebody to actually take the time to write a letter and send it into the corporate office, that they, you know, it probably reached a level where, you know, the thing that they did offended 10,000 people, right? Mm-hmm. So if they were to get 10 letters, 100,000 people, we have to issue an apology. But if you kind of superimpose that idea in today's culture, where we have everybody has a letter, you know, writing thing on Twitter or Facebook, so it takes 5 seconds. You don't actually have to write a letter, get an envelope, put a stamp, find out where to mail it, or do that. It's so much easier to voice your complaint. However, I think that the companies or the private actors or anything like that, they get these tweets. You know, maybe 10 people are complaining about something on Twitter, but they're still superimposing that times 10,000 mindset on it.
That's a fair point.
Can I just say, even in the physical letter world, and, you know, maybe I'm not an authority on this, but even that's really stupid to me. I think we got a problem in society that we kind of cater. I've said this before. We cater to idiots, assholes, and complainers. Like, that is not, it, to me, statistically speaking, how many people are the people who sit down and decide to write a letter to a company? It's probably one of the 100 people who like to complain about stuff.
Sure.
And honestly, I don't need those people in my business. Like, yeah. If anything, to me, before you start making decisions or focusing on the negative, you want it to hit a critical mass. I know I do that. Like, if we have product problems or I get complaints, it's like, I need a certain amount of complaints before I go, hey, there's an issue here. If not, I deal with assholes all the time. I deal with idiots all the time. There's a good chance this is just some idiot. So
right.
even in that world, you know what I mean? Like, just look at it from a statistical perspective. How many people, like, are going to sit down and write a letter to a company? Like, I bet it's the same people who were just writing letters to all these corporations because they were kind of having fun getting some attention. And you know what I mean? Some people just like to complain. They're best off just being ignored.
Right, right. But what Twitter has done is made it just that much easier for these people to complain. So where, you know, you might have a couple of, you know, nutballs or whatever that actually went ahead and did this. Now you've got 100 that could just tweet it from their couch, probably their toilet, you know, hashtagging the company itself. And then, you know, they get their voices heard. And kind of like my proof of this is, like, how many times have you seen a very outrageous headline talking about how people are upset about the new Moana movie or something? And then you go in there and it's just like 4 people non-verified on Twitter that are complaining. It's like,
quoted.
Is this really,
you know,
like?
I haven't thought about this till right now, but it'd be really interesting to take the Twitter. Someone could do this if someone had the tech for it, and probably exists. But let's say you have, like, the Shane Gillis outrage.
Mm-hmm.
If you take, like, the first day of complaints and you go onto Twitter and you basically take every single person who follows SNL and goes, "Hey, that's like my fan base here. If they're following SNL, they've got some sort of a relationship to the show," and then run that against the amount of people that are actually complaining about it,
yeah,
you get a pretty good statistical figure of how much of your audience actually cares.
That's actually,
and I bet if you did that more often than not, you'd end up with a negligible number.
Yeah, yeah.
Someone needs to do that. I like that.
Andy, you're on it.
I'm on it.
Yeah, you can think tank people. Can I just throw out more ideas to your team?
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, just send them straight to Andy. He'll take care of it. But yeah, I don't know. My word of advice to these companies is to just, like, this is going to sound bad, but ignore it for 48 hours. If it's still a problem and people are outraged on Twitter and it's still trending, then do something about it.
Yeah.
Because too many of these things are just like, oh, yeah, they pop up as, oh, it's trending on Twitter, cancel Netflix or something. And then the next day it's like, you know, Netflix is paying for advertisement on that same platform. So I don't know. It's just crazy stuff. And the idea that the OK symbol is banished to the lands of hatred is just utterly depressing to me. But let's move on to other depressing topics. All right. So so last week was kind of the Greta Thunberg story. Robbie, this is kind of our wheelhouse here at the Heartland Institute. We talk about climate change and climate alarmism and environmental policy pretty much day in, day out. Is this something that kind of ticks on your radar?
Oh, hell yeah. Absolutely. 100%.
Okay.
I love it because to me, I just see debt as being so much more corrosive to society, and I wish we could get some of this fear-mongering applied towards government's usage of debt. But for some reason, people are all on board with the global warming thing, and I think it's a threat because, like, we know the amount of wealth that's created by the use of fossil fuels, and they're lying to us because if we're really at risk for it and there's really concern for it, we should be using nuclear power. There's our quick solve.
Absolutely.
They're not really interested in solving it. It seems to be some sort of a power play. I don't really know exactly who's profiting or what they're looking to do, but this is the same thing as the threat of terrorism or whatever, where they go, hey, there's a boogeyman out there. We need to control more of the resources here so that we can fix the boogeyman problem for you. And whenever I just see that narrative from government, I know they're up to something.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm going to plug Michael Schellenberger again. Michael, I want you on this podcast so we can talk about nuclear power. Please come on our podcast. But he wrote this very interesting article that basically said that the reason why these environmentalists, or maybe just like the specifically kind of the left wing of the Democratic Party, the reason why they don't support nuclear power is because it basically would not allow them to completely overhaul society. That it's only because the wind and solar and how terrible they are and how much more expensive it would make the economy that it would require an overhaul of how society is structured. So that's kind of like his point of view, and that's kind of where I see all of this alarmism. That's the goal.
I've got a question for you guys, because you might have the insight on this, but it seems to me, I mean, technology develops over time. I mean, that's just obvious. We see the way we have cell phones with full computers in it. We didn't have those a couple of years ago.
Yes.
Now, from what I know, there's been, I mean, I don't know how many years the ban is. I'm guessing it's like 30 or 40 year ban on the, you know, creation of new nuclear power sites. You would know the exact number, but it seems to me like I'd love to know where that technology would be at now if we had been using it over the last 30, 40 years. And I'd said this on Part of the Problem, but like I know that the military uses nuclear technology. They got nuclear subs. I've also heard, and I'm not an expert on this, but I've heard that they can even like, they've got the equivalent of like generators for like army camps where they have like, you know, these small box nuclear reactor things that they can kind of use as generators.
That is cool.
That one, I'm very loose on that one. I think I remember reading that in regards to offering energy to Puerto Rico after that. They said that they think this technology, because I don't even remember where I saw that, but just what I'm trying to get at is I'm pretty sure if we had been invested in nuclear technology over the last 30 years and using that technology, that some of the risks associated with it would be way down. But I'm curious to know, you guys would, if you're working in this field, you'd have more of an expertise. I'd love to hear a little bit about that.
Yeah. And in fact, like those are some of the questions that I'd want to throw at Michael Schellenberger, his organization, Environmental Progress. Like that's all they do is nuclear policy and advocation. But I will say that the idea that wind and solar are going to be able to keep innovating and be able to compete with fossil fuels or even nuclear, that idea was kind of struck down by a report by the Manhattan Institute, where they basically said that the days of tenfold increases and there's basically like a diminishing return on the innovation when it comes to those power generations. And we're getting closer and closer to the theoretical limit of because those power sources are so dilute, you know, they're collecting wind and sunlight, right? So the idea that we're going to be able to power skyscrapers using that, with a solar panel the size of a stamp is just like crazy. But I've also heard Schellenberger talking about how like there is so much room for innovation in the realm of nuclear power. and how, yeah, like you hear about these things like thorium reactors or small module reactors that are basically impossible for them to melt down. So like these things, you know, when you saw like the HBO show Chernobyl that scared a whole generation of people away from nuclear power, it's like we are past that. And also, we don't have Uzbekistan controlling it or whatever. Was it Ukraine? I forget.
What, in the Ukraine under Soviet
Rule.
Yeah,
Ukraine under the Soviet rule. It's like, we are well past that, so...
And most of all, these people do talk about how wind and solar, they're having these tenfold increases. They're gonna, we won't need fossil fuels, they're cheaper, all that. Look, if that's actually true, then why do we need the federal government to fund this?
Mm-hmm.
They should be able to compete in a free market and end up competing with fossil fuels. It's clearly their narrative doesn't match up.
What's really interesting about that is if you look at the track record of the government-funded programs in both like wind and solar, the best chapter I ever read on that was in David Stockman's The Great Deformation. He's got a chapter about Obama's green energy initiatives, and he talks about some of the companies, you know, that are just self-funded tech companies that have made innovations and have been profitable. And then he talks about just literally the money wasted that Obama made investments in some green energy companies that were essentially just scams. They took the government money and they didn't do anything with it. So the idea that the government investment into this is going to solve the problem, I think if you read that chapter from Stockman, is close to certifiably false.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And then the other thing that the left has a way, especially in terms of climate change, they have a way of only looking at one side of the ledger, right? You got the benefits and you have the drawbacks.
Absolutely.
They only want to look at the potential benefits. But if you look at the drawbacks, so one of the things that that completely goes unnoted when you're listening to a liberal talking about how we have to pursue wind and solar is all the potential negative environmental effects that would come along with that. So one of the reports, I think this was also, this could have been Institute for Energy Research, it could have also been the Manhattan Institute, don't have those notes in front of me, but basically, if we wanted to transfer all of our energy production to wind and solar, it would take the land mass, the equivalent of California, in just wind and solar farms.
That's going to kill a lot of birds.
And that's not including transmission lines.
Yeah.
That's not including like areas that are privately owned. And like you have to basically level an area the size of California and dedicate it only to that. And not only that, but wind and solar are also very intense. They use, they're very mineral intensive and rare earth materials, right? So you're going to have to like strip mine countries to get all of the stuff needed for it. And on top of that, wind and solar panels and the turbines, they also have a lifespan. So they have to be replaced every 20 years. And when you make solar panels, you have to use a lot of potentially toxic materials, including like cadmium and lead, things that you can't just throw into a landfill. So what California is actually experiencing is mounting solar panel waste that they don't know what to do with. They have to basically treat it like it's nuclear waste, except for they have a ton of it, and it's growing every year because they have to replace these panels.
You've sold me. We got to switch over to wind entirely. I like these points.
But no, it's crazy.
That's fascinating. That's what I was saying at the, you know, kind of the start of the show. You really got to expose the cost of these.
Yeah.
And so the first cost is, it's almost, hey, listen, I really care about poor people. And if you go the direction of wind and solar, so firstly, some of these countries that are now developing will not be able to develop. People are going to starve. They're going to be in poverty. We're also going to have to go in there and we're going to have to seize all these resources from them in order to have wind. And, you know, and then here's the other thing. At the end of the day, you're going to end up with waste byproduct that's going to be just as harmful as what we currently have. So that's why this legitimately is not even an option that we should be exploring. And like, those are the kind of things that why aren't these people's feet being held to the fire that, all right, well, how much energy do you exactly want to get from wind? Okay, and how exactly is that going to work? Where are you getting the materials from? What are you doing with the waste products? And, you know, I guess they get to kind of play this card of, well, we've got magic sauce. Just listen to us. It can be all cured by the wind and solar. And then here's the craziest thing is, like, if you just kind of look at economic development and us continuing to use fossil fuels, the idea that like there won't be technological developments 50 years from now that we couldn't even conceive of could probably be solving a lot of these problems. You know what I mean? Like I'm almost more on team science and hope than these people are.
Yeah.
That, like, the idea that we're not going to come up with solutions to like real Earth problems in the future. Like, come on, guys.
Yeah, no doubt. And like one of the other craziest parts about this is even if we were to do that and sacrifice all of California to have wind and solar and, you know, screw over all the countries that we have to get all these rare earth materials, all of this stuff, forget about birds and endangered species that are flying around getting whacked out of the skies. It's not going to do anything because we produce 15% of global CO2 emissions. China does double of that just themselves, and they have no signs of turning around. So it's like we're basically chopping off our legs for no benefit.
And those people that talk about how China is actually like working hard to combat climate change and all that, I want these people to go to Beijing and to get off an airplane. Because when I went to Beijing and I was in an airport and I was looking at the airplane that flew me in there, there is so much pollution in their sky that you literally cannot see 50 feet in front of you.
No.
It's a little terrifying. You have to wear masks when you walk around. And people talk about how China's like leading the fight and fighting against coal power. Even
Do you know where that comes from, by the way?
Their factories?
No, so they're actually opening more and more coal-burning power plants ever, but they actually do produce a lot of solar panel stuff.
For us.
For us.
That's funny.
They sell it to us. So, yeah, we're just the dumb enough ones to use it. It's absolutely bizarre. But I started off this whole conversation, and you got me into a tangent about energy stuff, because this is kind of the stuff, again, we talk about all of the time. But I started this off talking about Greta Thunberg. So this actually ties into one of the first questions that I kind of brought up to you, which is about the academic versus kind of the other way to kind of sell these points to people. And I think that the global warming crowd, the Al Gores, they tried showing a bunch of graphs and talking about numbers and all of the science, and it seemed to not resonate with people. So I think that is why they've pulled out the Greta card and trying to appeal to emotion. So this idea of governing by emotion, what are your thoughts about that, Robbie?
Well, it clearly sells better. One of the best books on this, you ever read, I think it was just called The Crowd. It's a really short, small book, and it's like an early book on kind of government propaganda and kind of like the mind hive effect of massive crowds kind of don't make intelligent decisions.
Sure.
Have you guys ever come across that?
I have not.
No.
Interesting book. It's worth the read. It's kind of it's a really short read. But anyways, people don't really care about facts and reasoning. It's all about entertainment and sales. It's amazing that the UN, which you would think, hey, it's the most intelligent people who are really going to deal with the world's problems. Yeah. And we go, hey, we got this problem and it's global warming. Well, who's going to be our expert speaker about it? Do we have the Albert Einstein type guy who's really going to explain to us the threat of this? No, we found some 12-year-old girl from, what is it, Sweden?
Yep.
Yeah. We got an articulate 12-year-old girl from Sweden, and she's going to come in with her lunchbox. And you know what I mean? It's like, forget the science, forget the reasoning, forget the modeling, forget having solutions. Let's have some articulate child who can really yell and look angry and get us some good television highlights. Like so we're just very clearly outside of the world of intelligence and reasoning, which firstly is absurd, but also we can all understand, hey, seeing this articulate basically child actor is more convincing than listening to some science with their facts and reasoning.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know, it's actually kind of crazy. So we picked these topics. We're going to talk about this. We've kind of lined up these topics a couple of days ago. Just this morning, before I came here to record, I was going through Twitter, and somebody shared a video of basically the Greta Thunberg of 27 years ago. And she was in the UN, and she was talking about the threat of ozone layers, and basically how like the river by where she lives, like she's afraid to go outside, she's afraid to breathe the air, and it's like, you know, the final thing at the very end of the video is like, yep, that was 27 years ago. So it's just like, this isn't really new, I guess. It's just kind of one of those things. It just goes, it's cyclical, but yeah, they're just kind of going back to that old playbook, I guess.
I mean, we've seen a lot of that lately. And this is what's particularly sad about the Greta situation is they have this young kid who's apparently like autistic and incredibly depressed, who's now the face of this global climate alarmism movement. And to a degree, I think the tactic here is similar to the tactic with the Parkland shooting, where let's bring out kids to be the face of our movement.
Well, you can't criticize them.
You can't criticize them. So they're working this strategy where they're hitting on an emotional front, but they're also making it so anyone who wants to criticize their spokespeople are attacking kids, which is, I mean, we don't want to do that. She's a depressed little kid. It's just how they're getting their message across and the way that they're doing it. I just find incredibly malicious.
Yeah, I feel terrible for her.
Yeah,
like the idea that she's like been like clinically depressed, and just like if you listen to her speech talking about how like her childhood's been stolen from her. And like, you know, she's saying that in front of people, and she's saying that like basically like their empty words have done nothing. And then she says it, and then they're all applauding. It's like she's talking to you guys. What is going on? So I just feel horrible for her.
Well, there's also, it seems to be a bit of a pivot, even larger than Greta Thunberg, that, I mean, I'm not in school, I'm not a kid, I don't know what the teachers are saying to them. But it does seem like they're pushing the global warming thing pretty hard.
No doubt. And it
almost seems like it's that narrative, hey, you got to go home and talk to your parents. You got to get involved because this is going to be your problem. And the adults aren't being the adults here. So this is now on us to kind of go out and convince them. And so firstly, the idea that like, so you're in school and you haven't thought about these issues at all. Like, I'm more intelligent now than I was 10 years ago. I'd hate to see 22-year-old me talking to the UN because of something I heard and didn't really research. Mm-hmm. So obviously this is not a very good way for, like, you know what I mean? Imagine kids sitting in a room talking about how tragic it is that they have to sit in class and learn when they have so much more fun sitting outside enjoying recess. At some point, the parents go, okay, we get that, but you're a dumb little kid, so we're going to make some decisions about how we educate you. And that's kind of what I even saw footage the other week. There was a Senate hearing where Greta Thunberg was there and some other kids, and they're yelling at senators about global warming. And then some of, like, the Republican senators were given a little bit of pushback, but in the nicest way possible. But we really need to kind of be the adults and take a step back and go, hey, it's really tragic that that child is miserable.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit weird that you guys are tapping into her misery as a vehicle for selling your ideas. Mm-hmm. But why don't we actually have an adult conversation here about what the risks are and what are some solutions? And then, I get that those kids were victims of a school shooting, and that's tragic. That's the worst thing that should ever happen to anybody. But let's take a look at whether or not we really want to have a society without guns, and not have the crying kids there, because that's not really going to lead to intelligent conversation.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the sell there, is just to really go, all right, yeah, I agree with you. It's terrible that those kids are crying, and it's horrible what's happening to them, and that they're being educated something that might not even be true. So why don't we address her misery and see if we really have a threat here that needs to be addressed? Maybe we can go educate her on the fact that she can play outdoors and it's going to be great. You know what I mean?
Right.
You
can
almost
flip
it on them.
All right, sir, we have time for about one more topic, and I have two in front of me, so it's going to be guest choice here. We could either talk about Senator Bernie Sanders' extreme wealth tax and the idea of class warfare, or we can talk about banning of vaping flavors and the unintended...
I want to go banning.
What's that?
I want to go banning.
Banning. All right, let's do that. So, yeah, Bernie Sanders. We actually, last episode, we talked about this, extreme wealth tax. Billionaires should not exist. If you want a kind of a breakdown of this policies and how crazy they are, go back to last episode. But let's move on to banning flavors. So, a couple of weeks ago, I don't know, time flies by too quickly, there was a rash of illnesses linked to vaping that happened. And the response by the government was to, I don't know if they actually did it, but Trump proposed, or his administration, or maybe specifically his HHS guy, proposed a ban, nationwide ban, on vaping flavors to combat this idea. So it looks like you got something to say.
I'm a little excited here. It's not a ban on flavors. It's a mandate that the only flavor is tobacco.
You stole my thing.
That was your point?
Totally mine.
Oh, I'm sorry about that.
I said that.
Oh, yeah, but it was a good point. That's why I'm stealing it from you.
Yeah, there is no inherent flavor of e-liquids.
Yeah.
So the idea that they can only do tobacco is less of a ban on other flavors and more of a mandate that they have to do tobacco flavor. But yeah, I mean, we can get into the unintended consequences of this. But Robbie, I don't know if you're a vapor or a smoker or anything like that. But give us your two cents on this whole thing.
So the first thing to me that was very fascinating with the whole e-cigarette in the ban, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, but from what I've seen, the only things that have been a problem are essentially these off-market marijuana things that are using like vitamin E and some other chemicals. The best example I saw was if like people were making kind of a, you know, gin in their bathtub that turned out to be ethanol and people were getting sick. And then we turned around and said, hey guys, we got to get rid of all the alcohol in the liquor stores. The media did a really disingenuous thing here where I don't think there's been a single incident of a person getting sick from a Juul. I don't think there's been a single incident of a person getting sick from a flavor Juul. There's something going on here with the tobacco companies where months ago they were talking about, hey, kids are getting addicted because of all the flavors, and they were on this war with the tobacco companies and the flavors. They did a really disingenuous thing here that people are getting sick from off-market, like marijuana things being made in people's basements, not like these certified things from even your companies in California. I don't think a single person's gotten sick because of like a tobacco product. And if they had, it's definitely not from a Juul. And when they published the first articles on this, they had pictures of people holding a Juul saying people are getting sick from vaping. That was incredibly, from what I understand, please correct me if I'm wrong, but that's what I've seen thus far, was very disingenuous reporting by the media as a whole. And there's some sort of an agenda there because they wanted to tie this into getting rid of the flavors, which is a war they've been after for a while. Mm-hmm. And obviously you and I, we're libertarians. I don't really understand why, if there's a product that people want to consume, there's a company that wants to give it to them, why they shouldn't be allowed to both engage in that. But I just said a lot, so I'll let you guys.
No, you're absolutely right. There has not been any link of any of these diseases to specifically to these kind of above counter, actually on the market products like Juul that you mentioned. Michelle Minton from the Competitive Enterprise Institute has been following this real closely. In one of her articles that she published, she basically said that a lot of these cases, with the exception of like one or two, took place in states where recreational marijuana was illegal.
So
then when these people got these pods for like the THC marijuana vaping pods, they were these ones that were kind of black market. Somebody was making them in their garage type of thing. And yeah, they use this vitamin E, which apparently makes it less watery or something. It kind of congeals it a little bit more, so it looks normal. And that's what is leading to these diseases. So the idea that flavors are this is kind of tangential, I guess, to that point, but the idea that flavors are encouraging or are marketing specifically to kids. It's like, when are the last time these people went to a liquor store? Everything is a flavor.
Smirnoff mango.
Saying, and those are products only for adults, so the idea that kids are the only one that enjoy these wacky flavors is clearly an act.
And I've got here Lindsay Stroud here at the Heartland Institute. She also covers the concept of vaping all the time. In fact, she has a podcast called the
Voices with Vapors.
Voices with Vapors. And she wrote
Voices of Vapors.
Everything that I talk about will be linked in the show notes. But I've got in front of me a research and commentary that she just published talking about Illinois is potentially going to ban flavors if the federal government doesn't do it. And she's got a bunch of different stats in here. She says a 2013 study from the International Journal on Environmental Research and Public Health notes that flavors in electronic cigarettes appear to contribute to both perceived pleasure and the effort to reduce cigarette consumption or quit smoking. A 2015 study by the Consumer Advocates for Smoke-Free Alternatives Association surveyed more than 27,000 American adults. 72% of respondents credited tasty flavors with helping them give up tobacco. Apparently, adults like flavors as well. And then a 2017 study by the National Bureau for Economic Research concluded that banning flavors would result in an increased choice of combustible cigarettes or your standard tobacco. So it's kind of the unintended consequence of you're going to ban this thing that makes this alternative to smoking that much more enjoyable, and it's actually going to, you know, not save lives, it's probably going to cost lives by pushing them back onto regular combustible cigarettes. And then not only that, here's another thing, and when we talked about this a couple of weeks ago on the show, Justin Haskins, who's kind of a regular co-host on the show, he brought up the idea that, like, isn't this just going to lead to people, like, making their own flavors?
It's going to lead to more problems. Absolutely.
And that's going to lead to more problems. So I Googled that right before we came on the show. And I found this article from Vox, and that's V-O-X.
Okay. Great news source. Love
exactly. And the whole thing is about how there's a new do-it-yourself vapors community where it's just like it's on Reddit, apparently. 51,000 members on this Reddit board that's just basically trying to teach people how to make their own flavors if they can't get them in stores anymore. So the idea that the government is going to be able to crack down on something, they forget the rule of unintended consequences.
I mean, yeah, absolutely. And I have. First off, let's say that like the occasional person was getting sick from a Juul. These are still consenting adults that decided to move away from cigarettes and use these flavored nicotine pods. So first off, I don't think we can regulate people's behaviors based upon intended risks. What we can do is if a company goes out and says there's never been a health issue, and this isn't the case. The case is these black market THC pods. But again, like we know that cigarettes do lead to horrible health consequences. If we did know that a couple of people got sick from flavored pods, I still think that that's less negative than the cigarettes. And I think consenting adults have the right to choose what they want to do.
Also, I'm not really understanding, like, kids in the vaping, don't they know cigarettes is cooler? Like, what are they doing?
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, we got...
It's like, I get it, adults, like, you're stressed out all the time. It's like drinking coffee and need your nicotine fix. But when I was a kid smoking cigarettes, it was just because they were damn cool, you know?
You look good.
You have to drive home at some point. They helped you sober up. Write that down. That's actually
a new truth campaign by Robbie the Fire Bernstein. Yeah, you know, it's absolutely bizarre stuff. We play a game occasionally on this podcast where we say, what would be banned, if they were invented today by the government?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
So some of the examples that we talked about are like motorcycles. If somebody today, for the first time ever, came up with the idea of strapping tires onto an engine, and we're going to fly 70, 80 miles an hour down the highway, weaving in between cars, the government would say, absolutely not. Yep. That is banned. Yep. So it's like, and this, you know, this is another example. The idea that we're going to, you know, use whatever type of device, I don't know, the innards of an e-cigarette, to vaporize this liquid to give you an alternative, healthier version of the sensation you get from smoking cigarettes. And the government is banning it. Massachusetts just issued a 4-month ban on all e-cigarettes and vaping.
That's cruel, honestly. There's no other way to look at it. It's cruel.
It's insane. It's absolutely insane. Robbie, unless you want to give your final thoughts on this idea of banning stuff, I do have a couple of questions for you that are given by listeners.
Ooh, specific for me. I feel important.
That's right. First question. Would you entertain the idea of doing porch tours in other cities?
Oh, hell yeah. So what they're asking is we do on my podcast, we do a thing. It's called the Summer Porch Tour.
Mm-hmm.
And what we do is if listeners hit us up, they got a porch, we come to their house. We do the episode from their porch with them as the co-host. We've had a lot of fun with that. We've been in some really weird adventures. You got to check them out. They're a lot of fun. I'd like to go nationwide with the Summer Porch Tour. We just need to kind of grow the numbers to the point that, you know, that's financially, at the moment, if I did that, it would be irresponsible. I would be bankrupting myself to spend money to go to random people's porches and broadcast. It would be, it would be more sad than funny. But hopefully at some point we got the show numbers and the sponsor backing to make that happen. And, we'll be nationwide.
Yeah, I was actually listening to an episode of Run Your Mouth on the Way In, and I just, which is the podcast Robbie's referring to, and it is hilarious. I do want to recommend it to our viewers. It's actually a really good podcast.
All right, we're going to do it at your house, Andy.
I actually
in
have
Chicago.
A fantastic, I have two roofs that we can go on. It's absolutely fantastic. It'd make a great time for a porch tour if we allow roofs.
Another question.
People together.
Absolutely.
All right.
I've always been a stoop kid, too. I like stoops.
It's all the same idea. It's just, it's the outdoor. It doesn't like decks work, rooftops work. We've been in back alleys. Those don't really work, but we, you know, someone lied to us about having a porch. So we're flexible on the definition of the porch.
All right. Next question. What is your favorite sandwich?
Oh, you know, it's hard to discriminate. I got a lot of love for a lot of sandwiches out there, but I'm a big fan of a meatball sub. You really can't go wrong with those.
All right. Last question, also sandwich related.
What I told you. Yeah, from when I said I was a sandwich expert, you're like, I don't know what the hell this guy's talking about. But I'm telling you, people out there, they hit us up. They want the insight.
Yeah. Suddenly the viewer-generated questions made a lot more sense after you said that. So what kind of peppers do you prefer on your Italian beef? All right, hot or like sweet, I guess.
Question, because I'm not a big fan of Italian beef. I think Italian beef is more like the prosciuttos and like all those pork products that I didn't really grow up with. I'm more of a turkey and pastrami kind of guy myself, but I respect where people are coming from eating their Italian beefs. I like a hot cherry pepper. That's like if I had to commit to one pepper on a sandwich for the rest of my life, that pairs with any deli meat. Get a crushed red hot cherry pepper. You get them full in like the cans. You crush them up yourself. They're delicious. You can't go wrong.
All right. Fantastic. Well, I think that will about do it. I think we are out of time. So thank you, listeners.
I appreciate you gave me, a chance to explain some of my sandwich knowledge to new people.
that was what we really cared about.
Yeah, no doubt. Listeners, thank you for tuning in. Tune in every Friday for a new episode of the In the Tank podcast. Tune in every Friday. If you like our show, please subscribe, write a review for us on iTunes. We greatly appreciate it. You can find us on SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play, YouTube, pretty much everything nowadays. If you would like, you can follow us on Twitter at In the Tank Pod. If you have any questions, suggestions, anecdotes, jokes, feel free to email us at inthetankpodcast@gmail.com. Robbie, where can the fine people find you?
Oh, follow me on Twitter at Robbie the Fire. Aside from that, Run Your Mouth podcast out every week. And then Part of the Problem three times a week. That's got some of the best libertarian insights on what's going on weekly in the news. So definitely check that one out.
Fantastic. Thank you all for listening, and we will talk to you next week. Thank you.